Good morning. And welcome to worship at University Park United Methodist Church. I am Bethany Hader Krabs. I'm the Director of Wholeness and Healing here. If this is your first time worshiping with us or your first time in a long time, I see a hand. I need to slow down. Do I need to turn up? I'm good now. I'm still seeing shaking hand. Do I need to get closer? Is this better? Okay. If this is your first time worshiping with us, or your first time in a long time, I want to extend a special welcome to you. Our vision of ministry is to be a radically inclusive Christian community where families and individuals alike can flourish. We want to be the hands and feet and the heart of Christ for our neighborhood and the world beyond. This church is an active place, and we do a lot to serve our community and support one another in all of life. But even in all that activity, I think worship is the most important thing we can do as a faith community. We worship together to celebrate the image of God that we see in each other and in the world around us, to remind ourselves that ultimately this is God's world, and to remember who we are as the people of God. So whoever you are, whatever you may believe or question or doubt, you are welcome here. We'll be in the lobby after worship. If you'd like to know more about the church or to just say hi, we would love to talk with you. We have two special guests with us today. Our first is Valerie Erickson. She is going to be blessing us with some beautiful flute music. And then we also have Reverend Stephanie Price, who will be doing our sermon this morning. Reverend Stephanie is an ordained elder in the United Methodist Church and the founding pastor of an outdoor faith community in Aurora, Colorado called The Land. Stephanie is an ILF alumnus and has certifications in mediation, restorative justice, and Reiki. In all she does, Stephanie is dedicated to creating safe spaces for the human and more than human siblings who call this planet home. I'd like to acknowledge our tech team this morning. We've got Kathy Kelsey on taking video. Also, Patricia Clark is taking our Facebook Live. We have Tim Coble assisting us with the PowerPoint, and Dingo is running sound for us this morning. The video recording that's being made today using these tools will be posted to our YouTube channel so that people can watch it from home whenever they like. In addition to our YouTube video, we're streaming the service live to Facebook right now so that people can watch as it's happening. We're doing all of this to make our Sunday morning available for everyone who wants to be part of our worship, whether here in the sanctuary or at home. And now I've got just a couple announcements for you. We are getting ready for our Easter celebration, and so we need some help gathering candy. So we'd like for you to buy a bag of candy, bring it to the church, leave it at the welcome desk outside. There's a bin for you to leave your candy in. And then our volunteers will be stuffing lots of eggs in preparation for our big Easter celebration. That celebration will be happening on April 16th. And we will have food trucks, we'll have games and music, a big egg hunt. So invite all your friends to come. Invite your neighbors. We hope that we will have a good turnout for this event and that the weather will cooperate. But we hope you'll join us for a wonderful celebration for Easter. Our Holy Week services will be happening the week leading up to Easter. And so it will start on Thursday night. Thursday, Friday, and Saturday at 7:30 each night, we will have a service here. We'll have our Maundy Thursday, Good Friday, and then we'll have, forget what he calls it, Easter Vigil on Saturday. Now, at this part of the service, I usually don't talk quite this long, but I ask a question. I invite you to stand and find a few people around you to discuss the question. Today, our scripture is talking about waiting in hope. So I'd like for you to share something that you are waiting expectantly for. One thing that I am very excited about is next week I'm traveling to Tennessee to visit my family. So that's one thing that I'm really excited about. I haven't been there since Eleanor was 7 weeks old. So we're very looking forward to that. I'd like to invite you to share something that you are looking forward to. And if you don't have anything on your mind right now, recall a time that you were really excited waiting for something to happen. I invite you to stand now.
And in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, welcome. Please stand and join me in the call to worship. Holy is the one whose love birthed all creation into being. Shaped by harmony and wholeness, all the earth's creatures and creations once thrived in natural abundance. Though greed and corruption pluck us and tear us down, pollute and exploit, we are creatures of the soil, created to nurture collective life. Thanks be to God who gives us the power to resist evil and to choose paths that restore. Thank you.
That's a beautiful song. I've never actually sang that one before. What beautiful lyrics. Do you like that one? Yeah. Oh, how is everyone this morning? Are you so happy about the time change? Good grief. Is it not so nice to have it be past 4 o'clock and not pitch black? Good grief. Oh, I'm really happy to be here today. Can everyone hear me okay? No? Maybe, well, we want to make sure everyone can hear really well. So, Patricia's an amazing sound person, so helpful. Is that better? Yeah? Okay, great. Good. We want everyone to be included this morning. Oh, well, let's just start with centering ourselves. Maybe take a deep breath. We don't breathe enough. Holy Spirit, you speak this morning to us through the words of our ancestor, Paul, that we might be recentered in our purpose and placement in creation. May you place us in a moment of hope, unseen and yet so true. May we feel your love through the words spoken today. Amen. Well, Bethany did a wonderful job introducing me. Thank you so much, Bethany. And I love the welcome. It's just very well written, and you did a wonderful job with that. I'm Stephanie Price. I am an ordained elder, as Bethany said, and I've been here a few times. So I am an ILIF alum, so right across that street, and served in quote-unquote more traditional churches for 13 years before I found myself out at the land in Aurora, Colorado, which is 10 acres of short grass prairie land, the most endangered ecosystem in our country, that we are working so hard to conserve and restore through programs like our Summer Youth Mission Program, our weekly worship gatherings, our children's prairie school, our community garden, and much more. And if you're wondering about why this is so important right now, which I doubt any of you have that question of why this is so important, I just want to lay a little bit of the context for you, because like the Israelites who were exiled from their lands because they refused to give the land Sabbath, we too are being exiled from our own lands, from all of creation. See, geologically, time is split up into these, and this is my children's moment version of this. So if you are a biologist or an anthropologist or anything other than a seminary degree, just give me some grace here. But this is my understanding, right? So time is split up into these chapters. And there have been mass extinctions in the past, right? It's nothing new. But what makes our experience brand new, something that no other human has ever experienced, is that we are at the tail end of this geological age where there was the greatest number of biodiversity in the entire history of the world. We are living through our own Garden of Eden. Even the Garden of Eden would seem like desolate in compared to the world as it is right now in this moment. And yet we are at the tail end of this geological age. And extinctions aren't unheard of, but what's unique about what's happening right now is that the extinctions are human-driven. We're taking up habitat, we're causing more disease to spread, greed, in all sorts of different manifestations, is causing mass extinctions. And so we are entering this new geological age that has yet to be named, but by Edward O. Wilson, who is one of the most known biologists, is calling this the age of loneliness, envisioned by other biologists to be this global human monoculture. And a monoculture is like a field of one crop. So when you drive by in Nebraska, I'm sure some of you have driven and you see all corn, right? So the whole world, the whole globe is this green desert, an era of solitude. And when I was here last time, I talked about how our kids can feel this heaviness, how our kids know even more than we do the reality at a soul, at a spirit level, without maybe knowing even the facts or the historical relevance or the future threat. They grow up awakened to this reality. And so the words of Paul this morning are so important to understand at this deep and real level. There is this groaning, but Paul isn't talking about a groaning in what I understand a groaning to be, like, oh, that type of groaning. Paul is talking about a groaning in a, all of creation on its tiptoes in anticipation for us, the human species, to step up and be who we were created to be, which is visible. All of our potential, all of the hope for the world right now is visible, and the things that we are doing in the wrong direction, the stories that we are telling that are leading us astray and destroying this wonderful biodiversity of this new garden of era in our geological age. We are creative. We are determined. And we are committed when we want something. Do you not agree? When we want oil or land, when we want to build buildings or new neighborhoods, there is nothing that will stop us. And this is the story that we have committed ourselves, that we have invested in, that we believe in. And Paul is asking us to invest, to resurrect the story, not of our desires, but the stories of our inheritance. For we have proven that we are creative and determined and committed and loyal to our own needs. But that is not our purpose. That was not God's intent. But that we would be caretakers and stewards over all of this beautiful creation that exists not for us, but for its own purposes, sometimes mysterious and beyond our own understanding. What we need is a new way of telling stories, a new motivation, a new open door to see creation as partners, as equals, as worthy of existence and thriving, of habitat and health and happiness, just as we believe we are owed, entitled to, born into. We need a new story, and so we move backwards to remember the stories of our ancestors, of those communities who look and think and act differently than us, communities that we once rejected and tried to extinct, but today we lift up their stories, a Pawnee mythology, a story of a prairie dog and a young boy named Black Eyes. There once was a young boy named Black Eyes, who found himself desperately, hopelessly, some might say pathetically, in love with a young girl in his village. Each morning and every evening, when the young girl was sent to get water from the river, the young boy would sneak away to meet her at the river. And every morning and each evening when the young boy would meet the young girl would tell him to go away. Finally, one evening the girl had grown so weary of the boy's persistence that she turned to him and said, "Boy, I want you to know that I do not care for you. I can never marry you, and I do not want you to talk to me anymore. Although most of us could have predicted this ending, the boy himself had not. His eyes swelled with tears, and his heart throbbed so much that it stuck to the top of his throat and fell to the bottom of his stomach. The boy was humiliated and shocked, and finding himself brokenhearted, he went home, packed up his bow and his arrow, and left the village. Traveling east, the boy's tears carried him to a prairie dog town where he spotted a girl he had never seen before. The boy went to her, and soon they lived together in her lodge beneath the ground. But Black Eye's mother, missing him, went in search for her son. Following the place where the boy's tears had formed a stream, the mother found herself standing at the edge of the prairie dog town. The woman, believing that she would never again see her son, began to cry. All day, the mother lay in the prairie dog town and wept as the prairie dogs came to witness the mother's pain. When darkness fell and the woman went to sleep, a beautiful young woman came to her in her dreams, telling her, "Woman, you must not cry anymore for your son, for he is married to me. The girls of your people refused to marry him, and he came to our village, where he fell in love, and now we live happily together. Your son has not forgotten his people. But there is only one way he can return to you. You must go to your home. In his quiver there is a black arrow that the boy made himself and of which he thought a great deal of. Bring that arrow and lay it down next to the prairie dog hole and wait." Waking, the mother got up and ran home to find the arrow. Returning to where the girl had spoken with the arrow, she laid it down and then laid herself down along its side. When her son emerged from the hole, he took hold of the arrow and became a boy again. Speaking to his mother, the boy agreed to go home, but he said he could not leave behind his wife, for he loved her, and she was pregnant with his child. Calling to his wife, the pregnant female prairie dog followed as they journeyed back to the boy's village. When they finally arrived, the female prairie dog rolled in the dust and, touching the hand of her husband, transformed into a woman. Clarissa Pinkola Estes believes that stories are medicine. They have such power, she writes. They do not require that we do, be, act anything. We need only listen. The remedies for repair or reclamation of any lost psychic drive are contained in the stories. And so I ask us, what stories are we telling in our religious traditions, and where are they leading us to today? The Pawnee people birthed a story about the prairie dog and the boy from a fertile narrative alive with the fluidity between species and the interconnectedness between all of creation. It is a story of remembering the relationality of the created order held in the heartbeat of Mother Earth. In Christianity, it is the spiritual oneness, the material sameness articulated in the words opening the door to this Lenten season. Remember that you are dust, and to dust you shall return. Words spoken from human lips to human ears with a meaning that spans beyond the experience of one species. And perhaps it is dust and ashes only that remain of our religious stories of sameness. like the thousands of species that now face extinction due to human activities, the religious framework for our own sacred connectedness with all of creation is in critical danger of disappearing. And though we have redacted the words of the divine to embolden our delusions of superiority and practices of domination, it is these words from Romans that pull us back to the ground. We are not gods. Paul speaks to us today, for the whole of creation waits for us in eager expectation for the children of God to be revealed, for us to become who we were created to be. For creation is being subjected to frustration, not by its own choice, but by the will of the one who subjected it, by us. And so in hope we wait that through our own transformation, through our own ability to craft and tell a new story, all creatures will be liberated from their bondage to decay and brought into freedom, along with the glory of the children of God. I believe with all my heart that this is possible in this moment. And there are other moments when I sit in these pews and I pray with desperation and despair, when I want to give up everything that I'm doing because I don't feel like it's possible and I'm not sure that it matters. It is an up and down battle every single day. But what Paul is asking us to do is not to save the world, but to become who we already are more fully. And creation waits for us to step into this reality, to tell a new story, not a story of a prairie dog as an enemy to progress and a pest that must be exterminated, but a prairie dog who welcomes us with hospitality to become more of who we already are. On Friday, my daughter and I went to the Colorado Wildlife and Wolf Center, and I'm going to have somebody, whomever is responsible for all of your amazing communications, send out a picture. But my daughter was able to visit with a fox, and then when the fox was done, very quickly with the visit, we moved over to this wonderful habitat for a singing dog from Papua New Guinea, two of them. There's only 400 left in the entire world, and they all live in one place. And this beautiful, small little singing dog whose arms can move in a way that allows him to climb trees was so excited to greet my daughter. He cried and whined, just like a dog at your home would do when you haven't seen him for a while. So excited to see her, she got down on the ground and he climbed up into her lap and started licking her face. Only 400 left in the world because of things that we have done. And so eagerly and lovingly and gracefully, he welcomed her and reminded her that still there is love to be found and relationships to be built if we can tell a new story about our own arrival into a narrative that is bigger than this present moment. Imagine a story retold in defense of the divine, which rests not just in us, but in equal amounts in the prairie dog. A keystone species with far-reaching ecological effects within the landscape, providing food and shelter and a unique habitat for over 400 species who use the prairie dog colonies as habitat during some time in their life cycle. Imagine a story that circles so wide it wraps the prairie dog into our story, not only as a scientifically proven species that is critical to the health of the short grass prairie ecosystem, but as a sibling a fellow creature, bound to us as we are bound to them. Through the breath of the Creator that animates our lives just as it animates theirs. Imagine a story that is rooted so deep in creation and stretches so far beyond the cosmos that the prairie dog is the friend who takes us in when our hearts are broken from the groans of creation, begging to become free again. Imagine a story that is not told by us, but told to us, built within us to shelter us and feed us and give us hope. Imagine a story spoken by Paul to the Romans, given to us today, like the mythology of the Pawnee people. Our religious tradition has us to return to the land with a broken heart, that we might be transformed into oneness with all of creation. That in finding the purpose of all living beings, we might finally understand more fully a purpose that is our own. Amen. So I'll invite us to take a moment to listen for the prayers that we might ask God to hear, for those laments, that we open our hearts to allow this space to hold in these next few moments of silence. Holy Spirit, together we breathe in this place. Let this breath be our liturgy, a reminder of the sun and the plants that provide us this gift, with whom we cannot survive without. And you, O God, who breathe life into us, into our souls and our spirits, that we might be emboldened and strengthened to tell a new story. One where we imagine a fluidity between species, a connectedness so deep that we call it sacred. For here we gather with broken hearts, for the sickness of friends, for the loss of loved ones, for the fear of our future and the laments and regrets of our past. And together we stand before you whole and beautiful and perfect because of your reflection. May we live as the gift that we are, receiving your hope, even as it remains unseen. Together, let us pray the prayer you taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
My name is Patricia Clark, and I'm the Director of Children's Youth and Family here at University Park, and we are currently in our confirmation process, and we have 6 kids going through the confirmation process this year, and a couple things they're doing is they're learning more about this Methodist faith, about the founder, about the history, but something really, really cool they got to do was learn about the history of University Park, and we took them on a tour around the church, and they got to see old confirmation classes, old trunk or treats, old Easter celebrations, and it was just a really, really awesome time that these students got to really see all the different things that have kind of gotten us to where we are today. Now, one thing that they're going to learn later in the confirmation process is how to serve their church, how to serve here at University Park. And there's a couple different ways that they're going to learn, and that's through their prayers, praying together, not only as a youth group, but with the different congregation members. They can also serve with their presence, showing up, being a part of the service, being here for the congregation. Another way is through their service, serving in the community, serving in this church, volunteering, with their witness, being an active person who goes out into this world and tells them about the things that we're learning here together as a congregation at University Park. Another is with their gifts, whether that be financial or bringing in things that we need, maybe socks at Christmas to give to the homeless, different things like that. And so these kids are learning about that importantness of serving their community, of serving here at University Park. And so I invite you all this morning, whether it be through your presence, your prayers, your witness, or your gifts, I invite you that you would serve this church and however you feel led to. There are a couple different ways that you can give if you'd like to, and that is online at our new website, uparkdenver.com. You can give there or this morning here in person. We have a couple envelopes that are in the pews where you can fill those out. And then as you leave the service this morning, we have some offering plates back in the narthex, however you feel led. As Janet shared her story that in Ukraine now, in the billboards, they're showing Bible verses where it used to be hatred and things like that, which is very hopeful, very exciting to see that hope throughout Ukraine. And so I invite you all, rise as you are able, and let's sing this last hymn with this joy and this hope, knowing that change is happening, even sometimes if it's hard to see that there is hope.
Is my learning that I leave you with from the past year. Whenever you think that there are too many people doing something and you don't need to do it, or whenever you think people will think you're crazy if you say this and stand up for this issue, whenever you feel like there's no point, it means that if you stand up, if you speak out, if you stick it out, it's worth everything. May you go in peace, knowing that in your hearts and in your souls, God has given you everything you need to stand up, to speak out, and to stick it out through all the storms. Amen.